Spider-Man, Spider-Man, where have you gone to, Spider-Man? Where have you gone to, Spider-Man?
Welcome to another episode of Hart to Hart, where we get a little wacky and goofy, talk about games and movies, young and old. And today we're continuing the trend with the 2002 Spider-Man sequel. I also just started playing Spider-Man PS4 on twitch.tv/thepitlive. Here's a clip of that now. Oh, how you like the view, buddy? Oh my god. Oh my god. And now on to the movie. And honestly, just right off the bat, like the actual intro is so nice. This intro is so appealing. Show me more movies like this. This is what I want. Yes, this is what I want. After that, we see that, I guess Emma Rose is her name. She is now famous and Peter is now delivering pizzas, which is what we want. Everyone wants that. He just immediately has his mask in his pocket.
There was a disturbance.
There is a great disturbance in the force.
Multiple times in this movie, he's just like not trying to hide his identity whatsoever. And I was like, this is unacceptable. So that's a thing, but we continue. So we get Spider-Man for the first time in 5 minutes in or so. And hilariously enough, he's got to swing around and deliver a pizza. And then he ends up saving some kids. But when he takes the pizza, of course, right immediately, when Peter goes to change, he brings the pizzas. And then Spider-Man's away and he's still holding the pizzas. This one dude's like,
whoa, he stole that guy's pizza.
And it's hilarious. You kind of find out as it continues that, I mean, that I guess becomes more important later because you find out that like they don't actually like Spider-Man. There's this bit in a closet, which I don't understand. I'm not even going to try to explain. There's the pizza time.
Pizza time.
Amazingness, 10 out of 10, real time. Peter gets fired after. Well, 15 minutes is just Peter getting shit on, honestly. It goes home, forgets his birthday, and we immediately see that there's some tension. People are feeling things. It's like, what's going on with him and MJ? What's going on with Harry? It's like they're both kind of mad, but not really. MJ's just playing a different kind of game, where Harry's more like, tell me where Spider-Man is and I'll be pissed. And I think that Harry knows deep down. I think a lot of people already know deep down. Through a lot of the movie, I was like, man, I feel like Harry knows. I think MJ knows. I think Aunt May knows. Like at one point, I'm like, okay, Doc definitely knows, but we're gonna get into that later. But the whole reason why I'm explaining like any of this, it's like this whole beginning, the whole 15 minutes, it does a great job of setting the time and the place of the movie, how far it's taken after the first one. Like Aunt May has a great line where she's like,
can you believe that it's 2 years next month since he was taken?
So it just does like a really good job of setting the time, which I like appreciate that a lot. So I really enjoyed that. We meet just the best character in the whole movie, this man. And this whole business here, St. Peter, he's moved out and he's behind on his rent.
I have a paycheck due this week. And
you're a month late again. Again?
And he's got a small apartment. He's got fired from his job. He's pretty down on his luck at this point. But luckily, Harry actually did something, was actually somewhat of a good friend for once. And he got Peter hooked up with Dr. Octavius for his science project. Oh, we saw Dr. Connors too within the first 15 minutes. So that was also cool. Also, something cool about this first 15 minutes when we see Dr. Connors. Peter drops his books and he gets whacked by a bunch of bags. See this bag right here? See this one? That's the director. That's right. And that's, I'm going to point it out every time I see it. Yeah, then we need Dr. Octavius. And then this is another example of a great way to set time. I don't know. Did that even make sense? Okay, basically, they're talking about science stuff. And then the scene transitions to them at the table. And he asks him a question that he would have asked him like immediately after their interaction in the lab. And then they're randomly at this table and he asks him a question. And he's like,
Peter, what have we been talking about for the last hour and a half?
Time. I appreciate that shit so much. After that, we have another great example of why this Peter is super irresponsible. He's like, yeah, no one's going to see. It doesn't matter. And, you know, to be fair, no one does see. But and also, this is a great example. This weird idea that putting colors in with whites does this thing. It doesn't, does it? I feel like I've been conditioned to believe this. So then we have another strike against Peter where he is trying to go to MJ's performance. He buys her some flowers. And his bike gets cracked. But then he does a backflip and he's like, eat your vegetables. And the kids are like,
that's what my mom is always saying. I just never actually believed her.
And then honestly, almost like a whole whack ton of like 50 people almost die and he saves them all. So if you really think about it, him being late and what happens after, I mean, you know, Well, I guess not like immediately what happens after that, because I've seen this movie, but I feel like I don't remember how certain things happen. And this was one of the things I didn't remember how or where or why he really lost his like power ability thing. So in this scene when he's just swinging it and then he's like, okay, bye. It's insane. It's another reason why I love the series so far so much is that, man, the noises Toby makes when he is making an error and falling is very real. And then we have another bit in the elevator, which is like a pretty good bit. Yeah, I don't have much to add on that one, except that this was not scripted. They just let the actors riff off each other, which I think is absolutely hilarious. Adds a lot of charm to the scene.
It rides up in the crotch a little bit too.
But as what happens after that, that's bad. That's even badder bad.
Fasten your seatbelts.
I know he explains all signs and stuff, but I don't understand why he can just kind of stand there and wear goggles, and no one else is wearing goggles, but he's wearing goggles, and then there's like nothing. Is there some invisible force field from the sun, he says? I don't get any of that part, how no one is dead in the first place, or like how this thing doesn't have like a massive gravitational pull to it. And like the goggles thing is important, because, you know, if other people had goggles on, then this whole scene would have went really different. A really badass thing in the scene, though, is when Peter saves Harry, and Harry's just like,
this doesn't change anything.
That is some hardcore shit. And even immediately when he goes outside, he's like, man, he had just embarrassed me by touching me. And there's like people dead around him, person dead. He just doesn't even care. He's just so angry. In the first one, it was like you weren't sure how angry or if he was like bad. But in this one, you're like, yeah, he's definitely not happy. Then we have Alfred Molina shirtless, which I want more. And then Peter goes to give more pictures to Jonah. And that's not really the important part. The important part is the transition that they have from this scene to the next scene at the docks. It's like, I kind of get it. I feel like, this is just my opinion, that there's a very similar transition in the first movie, which I literally point out in my other review, which is like here or something. I feel like they tried to do that here.
The planetarium tomorrow night, 8:00. There's the door.
And it just was not the same thing. Did not work out. It was some weird like wave effect. It was just unsettling, cut off half of that scene. But then it was okay, because the scene it cut into was just, it's just beautiful. I love, this to me is a very similar scene to the mirror scene in the first movie with the Green Goblin. But in this one, it's like him kind of, this is where he kind of breaks and he kind of is becoming Doc Ock. And when he's like,
I miscalculated. I couldn't have miscalculated. It was working, wasn't it?
And that's kind of the point right there, where everything changes for his character anyways. That scene's a standout scene in this movie. Very good scene. The next one threw me for a loop because Jeff is just in it. And I'm like, Jeff, get out of here. You're in the wrong movie or show, or just get out of here. The whole scene after with him saving Aunt May was like, nice. It was very good. And this is like kind of another example of how Spider-Man gets help, doesn't always do it on his own. And it's like, it's nice, because who knows what happened if Aunt May didn't whack him in the back of the head there. Saving Aunt May beautifully and then just kind of taking off. So the next scene is actually huge. This is definitely like Peter's breaking point. He goes to like a gala to take pictures for his boss's son. But then what really kicks it is when the Buzz Lightyear guy comes down the stairs, and around his arm is MJ. This is a good reveal, actually. I've seen this movie and I was like, who's her boyfriend? I wanna know. And then later on I was like, wait, it's that guy, True. Oh, True. And it was also very sad. And then even after that, Harry just drills him even more, just claps him.
Huh? Isn't that right? Huh, brother?
Like, and he knows that Peter is definitely hurt in this point, and he just takes advantage of it and just completely humiliates him.
I find him with my father's body, and you defend him because he's your bread and butter.
Take it easy.
Hey, don't push me.
Don't act like you're my friend. You stole MJ from me. You stole my father's love. And you let him die because he didn't turn in the freak. Isn't that right?
Yeah, the whole bunch of the first part of the movie is just down for both Peter and Spider-Man. They are not having it. They're not one. They're both having a rough go. And then Peter goes to a doctor, and another great example of how a bunch of people know that Peter Parker is Spider-Man is because he literally is like, yeah, I have these dreams that I'm Spider-Man, and I climb a wall and then I fall. And at first he sounds like kind of, the doctor could just be like, okay, this guy's weird. Then he's like, it's not even my dream, it's my friend's dream. He's like, okay, that's kind of weird. And then the doctor very clearly knows.
So you're Spider-Man.
And then after not shaking Uncle Ben's hand, who they clearly got to come back to act for this. And if you want to talk about great comic book representation, boom. Oh, so nice. So beautiful. And then after we see Peter's, he's starting to do well, starting to do better. Everything's starting to go well for Peter. He even sees a guy getting beat up and is like, nope, not going to deal with that because I'm Peter, and kind of just leaves. And he's doing so good. He tells Aunt May the truth about that night with Uncle Ben. She gets super upset and leaves. Which in a way was like kind of a surprise because she's such a forgiving character. She even gives it off with everything about her is like forgiveness. And then Peter goes to take her hand and she walks away as like, it's like very powerful. Then it just is silence. Until it cuts away. So then we see Harry in a kind of similar manner at a breaking. Well, him and Peter's breaking point were actually in the same scene. That slap, I think, was a big deal for Harry. More than Peter, I feel like. So when Doc comes and he's like, I need some of that stuff of whatever science stuff. Harry's like, okay, well, I'll give it to you if you give me Spider-Man. And who can give you Spider-Man is Peter Parker. And then as he leaves, he says,
don't hurt Peter!
He kind of waits. That was kind of sketchy. Like he had some regret. Like maybe I shouldn't have told him that. So he's like, don't hurt him. But yeah, this is what obviously turned extremely bad for Peter. Then Peter gets a call. It's from Aunt May.
It's your aunt.
So he goes to see her and she kind of said, you know, Talvin, I'm moving out, I'm moving on. And it seems like she's very relieved now that she knows what happened. She's not hurt. Like I said earlier, in her character almost, she is just extremely forgiving. And then Spider-Man's brought up and see how much it means to Aunt May and to this little guy whose name I forget. Yeah, so it's the scene after that I'm like, maybe Doc does know that Peter is Spider-Man. Because Peter and MJ go to meet and he just straight up throws a car at them. And if he wasn't Spider-Man, if he was just a normal dude, he would not have seen that. They would have been just dead. Both of them smushed. Poof. He's like, yeah, don't hurt Peter. He's like, I won't. But aside from that, the scene has a ton to offer. We see that MJ has actually come around and she wants to give Peter a chance. And Peter's like,
my mind was playing tricks too.
Kind of backpedaling on what he said before. But she knows that he loves her, so she's not willing to give up at this point.
Kiss me.
Kiss you.
And then we have some beautiful camera work.
Peter Parker.
And the girlfriend.
Some great tension building, a stellar scene between Doc Ock and Peter. Ton of stuff to offer. So Peter goes to get his suit back, which low-key is hilarious because Jonah just has it pinned up on his wall like it's a cross or something like that. And I knew watching him, like, I know the train scene. I know that's gotta be coming up soon, but I couldn't remember how. I couldn't remember when or how certain things happen. So when they happen, I was like, oh, it was like I was watching for the first time. I was like, oh, that's sick. Well, that's cool. It's dope how they did that. Like, you can kind of see the subway below, the subway, the train car, whatever the fuck it is, subway. You can see its tracks as they fight. And then they finally fall and it's like bang, and they're on a fucking train. It's like And the way he like moves from in the train to out of the train to on top of the train, it's a great scene. I love how at one point, well, this actually happens a bunch of times throughout the movies, but you see that his costume is like, it's black and red. And then you see once it kind of gets into more sun, it's blue, because it's blue and red. Pretty sure it's because in the comics, it's black and red. But that's because it was supposed to be blue. You were supposed to visualize it as blue. But then we have the dope train scene.
You have a train to catch.
Which I guess it's like, it's fair why he took off his mask, because it was literally on fire. So then he goes in front of the train, tries to stop it with his feet. That doesn't work.
Any more bright ideas?
I got a few.
and then does the web thing. And this just still looks great. Look at this, it's so cool. And then just like in the first movie and just like earlier on in this movie, Peter is saved by the people of New York, bringing him to the train. And then everyone's looking at him and he's like, oh my God, I don't have my mask. This Spider-Man is for the city. He is the city. He symbolizes the city and they all know that. And they're like,
we won't tell nobody.
And he puts his mask back on. It's in much better condition than when he left it. I'm gonna just say it. It really is. And then he gets knocked out and captured.
But not without a fight.
If you want to get to him, you got to go through me.
And me.
This next part also cuts pretty deep too. He brings him to Harry. And I love this scene. I really do. It's another great like Spider-Man moment. Harry having the proper reaction to finding out who Spider-Man is.
First we'll see who's behind the mask. We can look into your eyes as you die. Peace. No. It can't be.
There are bigger things happening here than me and you. Harry, please, I've got to stop him.
So the next scene, really the final fight, I feel like, was the train fight. That is, I think, the final fight. Because the final confrontation is more of Doc threw something at Spider-Man that Spider-Man should have been able to, like, know that was coming because of his spider sense thing, which is just inconsistent. Spider-Man gets his ass kicked, I think, similarly like the first one. But then he uses his brains, which is super appreciated. He stands there in this hilarious pose.
Now what?
Which I just have to point out, it's so funny. He's like, why? Why? Then this gravitational pull of all of the stuff, like it was literally pulling in like cars from, I don't even know where these cars were. And it was pulling in parts of the building. And yet Doc is chilling in the water. His arms are no more. Peter's chilling in the pose, even though when we cut away, he was looking to the right. And then it cuts back and he's chilling in that Y pose. And then he looks to the left and he's like, hey, I'm Peter. And then Doc decides that he can be good now.
Listen to me now. Listen to me now.
Fights away the arms. He decides that he doesn't want to die a monster, so he's going to take down his creation. And then once Doc leaves, MJ just like stares at Peter, and then it looks like it's going to kill her a bunch of times. And he shows up and saves it. And I really love this because he's just like, this is really heavy. And she's like, yeah, it looks really heavy. Their whole story, their whole story, this whole movie is just beautiful. I loved it so much. Such a, oh, so beautiful. And then Doc goes down.
I will not die a monster.
And even after all that, they still decide to not be together in this beautiful web that Peter had set up. And it is beautiful, it looks sweet. So at this point, Mary Jane thinks that because she knows that Peter is Spider-Man, that this is why he had always said no, and now they can be together. I think that's what a lot of the audience thinks too. And Peter pulls a huge Spider-Man move, like really just.
And you know why we can't be together. Spider-Man will always have enemies. I can't let you take that risk. I will always be Spider-Man. You and I can never be.
Yeah, it is super emotional, and I loved it. And then we get a scene that's really more of a setup. It's just a huge setup, basically, for the next movie, where Harry has a conversation with his dead dad, and James Franco does such a good job, and Willem Dafoe does such a good job. And he was not even supposed to be in this movie. He was just, you know, Willem Dafoeing by the set, as Willem Dafoe does, and just kind of walked in to say hi, and they were like, hey, you want to be in the other Spider-Man? He's like, yeah. And that's a fact. That's true. That happened. And in the end, he doesn't want to avenge his dad because Peter's his friend. He's like extremely conflicted and he doesn't know what to do. And he's like, no, Peter's my friend. And he doesn't so quickly give in. So it's interesting to see like what's going to happen between now and I guess the next movie that kind of caves his temptations. Then we ended on a happy note, not for the Buzz guy, this dude.
Call Deborah. Tell her not to open the caviar.
But for Peter and MJ, it definitely does. And then just like the first movie, I'm going to show you a scene that has no business being in a Spider-Man movie. I literally love this. I thought this was beautiful. I thought that was just beautiful. I really did. I was like, that was a beautiful shot. Yeah, but our conclusion is MJ and Peter, they get together. Peter swings off into the night. Sits there kind of waiting, and that's it. That's the movie. It is a good fucking movie to front to back. I feel like it is more of like a, it's almost more of a love story with MJ and Peter and Peter and himself. Like superhero movies and a lot of movies in general, like when they get sequels, they just never live up to it. But this one did a fantastic job of living up to it, completely delivering, being comic accurate, having a crazy love story, extremely compelling villain with a short and interesting backstory, and a cute and comfortable conclusion. I thought this was great. It's like another key example, like I was saying it in the first one, that like this series is a big Peter Parker series. There wasn't even that much Spider-Man in this movie. When there was, it really hit the spot. It did really well. Okay, so I thought about it a little more, a lot more. It's a new day. First, I was like, yeah, it's pretty good. But then the more that I thought about it, the more I realized that like every single scene is important in this movie. Like every scene. It was really hard to decide what clips to use and really even how to tell the story of the movie without just going through the entire movie, basically. So I'm actually going to bump it up. I'm going to bump it up to 92. I'm doing it. I'm saying it right now. 92. Yeah, 92 hertz. 9.2 hertz. So there's that. I hope that clears things up. And the next review you will see will be of Spider-Man 3. Hope you guys had fun. I know I did. And we'll see you soon.